Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Living in the Moment, a guide to overcoming challenges and finding moments of joy in Alzheimer's disease and other dementias, by Elizabeth Landsverk, MD. Narrated by Elizabeth Landsverk, MD. To my elders, who have taught me more than medical school ever did. Introduction. No affliction of old age is more likely to be treated ineffectually than dementia. The onset of dementia is gradual, complicated, and subtle. Successfully addressing medical and behavioral needs requires finesse. Sadly, too often, the effort is unsuccessful. I know about this firsthand. After graduating from the University of Virginia Medical School and completing a residency at Harvard, I worked as a primary care physician for 7 years. One day, an older man came into my clinic complaining of chest pain. I tried to do an electrocardiogram to check his heart, but the man started hitting everyone within reach. He was out of control. I had asked the staff members to take him away. It bothered me that I didn't know what to do. The incident inspired me to do a fellowship in geriatrics, medicine for elders, at Mount Sinai Medical Center in New York City, one of the world's leading centers for research on treating people as they age. I focused on the mental health problems of old age. After finishing my specialty training in geriatrics, I became an assistant clinical professor at the University of California, San Francisco, UCSF. But while UCSF is one of the top 10 medical research centers in the country, I found that academic medicine didn't suit me, that clinical care was my passion. I wanted to have more freedom to direct that care and more opportunity to teach the techniques that I had learned at Mount Sinai. Now, I knew how to handle an elder who becomes uncontrollably violent at the prospect of a routine test. Even more important, I knew how to prevent the outburst in the first place. I left UCSF 14 years ago to form my own independent practice, Elder Consult Geriatric Medicine, specializing in house calls for older patients. I also served as a medical director for a hospice providing end-of-life care. Education and outreach had become increasingly important to me. Doctors usually give talks to other doctors. I wanted to spread awareness in the community, to let lay people know about alternative ways of treating the mental health problems of old age, especially agitation, depression, and psychosis. I advocate using sedating drugs as little as possible. I emphasize behavioral modification and lifestyle changes. As a society, we tend to both under-medicate and over-medicate, giving too many tranquilizers to some elders while not addressing the pain or disruptive and irrational behavior of others. We are loath to take the decision-making power from our elders, and we have imperfect tools to measure whether a person has capacity or the ability to run his or her own affairs. The result is that many elders with early dementia suffer some kind of psychological, physical, or financial abuse. Then, when we do step in to manage the elders' lives, some of us take too much power, forgetting to allow them the freedom to choose what they want to eat, what they do, or whether they want to have a romantic partner. Even more commonly, dementia treatment is non-existent. Only 1 in 5 of those with symptoms of dementia have been diagnosed, according to testimony before the United States Senate. Even when they're on the case, families, caregivers, and health professionals often find it difficult to assemble all the necessary information or resources to address the complete picture. Families may exhaust themselves, both physically and financially, caring for a demented relative, unaware of the many kinds of support available. Caregivers may grow frustrated, unaware that very simple adjustments to daily routines can sometimes make all the difference for a demented elder. At some time in our lives, almost all of us will have to cope with these vexing problems. About 10% of people over the age of 65 suffer from failing brain function. After age 85, that figure rises to approximately 50%, according to the Alzheimer's Association. Alzheimer's is the 5th leading cause of death among people aged 65 and older, according to the organization's data. And while other major causes of death have decreased over recent years, the incidence of mortality due to Alzheimer's has risen 46%. This doesn't even take into account other causes of dementia, such as alcoholism, Parkinson's disease, or small strokes. So perhaps it's not surprising that, again and again, I've met elders and families struggling to deal with the problems created by faltering mental function. and again, I've seen families completely overwhelmed, exhausted to the core, unsure where to go for information, and unable to untangle the intertwining medical, psychological, interpersonal, legal, and practical knots created by a loved one whose ability to think is failing. It is possible for elders and their families to live fulfilling lives after a dementia diagnosis. I decided to write this book to give families a straightforward map and toolbox for the road ahead. Before beginning any journey, you need to have some idea of where you are and how you got there. Then you can see where you're going. You can see your goals and what help you need to achieve them. Only then is it possible to survive, even thrive on this path. This book will give you what you need to do just that. Anyone who's faced a medical or family crisis knows that during the first few months, the learning curve angles straight up. There is so much new information to absorb, new terms, new resources, new options, new questions, and new processes. Dementia is both a medical crisis and a family crisis. It strikes at the core of identity and relationships. That makes the affliction even more challenging. A quick click around online or a browse through the local bookstore shows there's no shortage of books about aging and dementia. Some purport to hold the key that will lock out old age indefinitely. Hefty medical tomes outline advances in dementia research. Poignant memoirs bring on the tears. One man even chronicled his own descent into dementia. Giant overviews published by groups like the Alzheimer's Association or the For Dummies book series cover just about everything you would want to know about the current state of dementia treatment. Several doctors have written books offering their point of view on the subject of aging and cognitive decline. All of these works have their place. However, I believe that in the midst of a crisis, in the first days, weeks, and months before and after a dementia diagnosis, families don't need emotive memoirs, encyclopedic medical explanations, or magical thinking. Since 4 out of 5 elders with dementia live at home, and caring for these people is more than a full-time job, neither patients nor families have a lot of time for reading. What's been missing is a concise, easy-to-digest overview of what you'll need to know for the months and years ahead. You want practical advice on just getting through the day. You need a smart reference for what to do right now, rather than spending hours flipping through pages and pages of details to identify the right one. That's what this guide does. You'll also need to recognize that while dementia is a discrete medical condition, it affects the whole person and the whole family. Therefore, I believe that the treatment should be holistic, with practical steps that take in all of life, from bank accounts to bathing, from depression to dental care. Too often, when an elder with dementia is suddenly violent or inappropriate or in danger of making a disastrous financial decision, various professionals discount these problems as not part of dementia, or something that must be endured, or the elder's right to be foolish. Often, many of these problems can be solved by recognizing the signs of early dementia, by determining what care plan and team are needed, and by considering whether an adjustment of a medication is appropriate. This means understanding what drives odd behaviors in dementia. It means working with the elder, not insisting that he or she faces the calendar and says, "It's a Wednesday in May." It means understanding what the world looks like to these elders and helping them with compassion and patience to navigate the bewildering world that this disease has made their reality. When all else fails, I strongly believe in using medication to treat the behavioral problems of dementia. This point of view remains controversial, but I've seen it work for many elders. Some of the families of these elders tell their stories in this book. Families and their loved ones also need reason for optimism. I fervently believe that dementia is a challenge that elders and families can meet with success. Dignity, grace, even joy are still possible with the relevant information and an integrated plan. All this requires preparation for the long haul. Dementia rarely runs its course in a year. Sometimes it may go on for a decade or more. Each situation has its own story, its own subtleties, and its own challenges. Dementia isn't as straightforward as a broken bone or a heart attack. Strange things can happen. A once adoring spouse can become violent and paranoid. a once confident professional may suddenly suffer from crippling anxiety. A once efficient executive may stop paying her bills or make loans without paperwork, giving away large amounts of money to unscrupulous family members and outright strangers. Families need to access the key facts on how the brain works and how different kinds of dementia lead to different behaviors. They need to know the early signs of dementia. They need to know how dementia is diagnosed and how it is treated. They need to understand how the world looks and feels to an elder with dementia. They need practical advice for day-to-day living. They need to know the importance of putting their family's legal and financial house in order. They need to know the signs of elder abuse. They need to know how to find options for support and care of both family and the elder. They need to know how to judge whether a facility or a caregiver or a program is right for their loved one. This book will cover these basics in short, easy to find, and easy to understand sections. It will outline the most common issues and resources. It will detail concrete steps to help you through the process in an integrated, holistic way. These are the things I would like every elder and their family to know from day one. No book on such a vast topic can be all-inclusive. This guide shouldn't be considered as direct advice on medical matters, financial planning, or case management. What it can do is help you ask the right questions of doctors, elder care lawyers, care managers, caregivers, physical therapists, occupational therapists, facility managers, and other professionals. It should give you the tools to determine the right solutions for your unique situation. Let's get started. Chapter 1. First things first. You're listening to this book because someone you love has been diagnosed with dementia, or you suspect that your loved one's forgetfulness or quirky behavior may be something more serious. You may be feeling confused, frustrated, hurt, or frightened. You may be aching with anxiety or grief as your relationship changes profoundly and permanently. The problem may feel so big that you're reluctant to look at it fully. One of the most heartbreaking misconceptions I see in my practice is when families assume that a diagnosis of dementia means that life won't be worth living any longer. Nothing could be farther from the truth. Life can still be rich, but this requires that we reconsider some of our assumptions and expectations about life and about dementia. The biggest lie is that dementia means it's all over. Have hope. You can still enjoy good times together. A diagnosis of dementia doesn't mean the end of the world. Yes, a family's life changes when dementia enters in. Sometimes the shifts come dramatically. An elder will have a sudden health setback. Dad will go out for a drive and will not be able to find his way back. Mom may try to escape her assisted living facility because she's convinced they are trying to keep her prisoner. Yet, as we will discuss, these setbacks can be overcome. Life can continue to bring love, joy, and fulfillment. With the proper support and information, people with dementia can have engaging and enjoyable lives. I have helped thousands of families and elders find solutions to the challenges that make elders miserable. Untreated pain, medications causing agitation, lack of caregiving knowledge and strategies, or the needed level of care to live with joy and contentment, even as the decline progresses. Of course, the goal of this guide is to give you the ability to live with joy and contentment too. What it takes is proper care, support, and education. This book aims to begin that process. You may wonder if you're overreacting. Does my loved one really have early dementia? How can I tell if there's really a problem? First signs. The earliest stages of dementia are often the most difficult to identify and deal with. Where is the line between eccentricity and dementia? Between normal forgetfulness and dementia? Between stubbornness and dementia? Between normal caution and demented paranoia? Nearly every family I work with clearly remembers the confusion that set in when they first started to suspect that something was wrong with their elder loved one. Here are a few examples from relatives of my patients. Ellen, about her mother-in-law. She started leaving the oven on. She would forget to flush the toilet. She didn't remember if she'd eaten or not. Kelly, about her husband. He'd always been good with our finances, but then he began to pay some bills late or he would forget to pay them at all. That wasn't like him. Robert, my father was only in his 60s when we noticed something was off. He was an attorney and always very organized. But he started to forget appointments, meetings, and even my son's birthday. He forgot to take his medication. He forgot to do his taxes. His mail was piling up. But when I commented on this, he got angry. Brian, about his wife. She started having problems at work. She had problems with her speech, stumbling over her words, forgetting some words completely. I started to notice that she'd use the same catchphrases over and over. Forgetfulness is common. If these things happen once or twice, it might just be a mistake. But if you start to notice a pattern, it may be time to check things out. If there are repeated financial lapses, you may need a trustworthy agent, like a fiduciary or a conservator, to manage their finances. If you're comfortable discussing finances with your loved one, bring up what's causing your concern. If you see red stripe notices from the power company or the tax collector on the desk of your father's study, don't hesitate to talk to him about it. It's not snooping. It's protecting your loved one. Often, elders are hesitant to turn over their financial control to their adult children. In this situation, try to emphasize the hassle of bills. At times, it makes sense to have a third-party professional, especially when there's discord in the family. Explain that a professional fiduciary can take on that burden without taking control. You may also notice behavioral and mood changes. In the early stages, an elder might also appear reasonable most of the time. She might also, however, begin to spin suspicious tales, convincing the authorities that her husband is beating her, or that the housekeeper is stealing, or that a caregiver is climbing into bed with her. Of course, these stories should be checked out, but it may well turn out that the husband simply patted her on the hand, or that she misplaced her pearls, or that the caregiver must kneel on the bed to help her change her incontinence underwear. The early stages of dementia may be the most challenging to families. Without warning, their loved one is acting strangely, cranky, unpredictable. It's difficult not to feel frustrated or annoyed. It can feel as if the person is willfully misbehaving, ruining the day on purpose. The important thing to remember is that people suffering from early dementia aren't trying to be difficult. They can't help their perplexing behavior. They may not be consciously aware that they have changed, or they may be acutely aware of the changes and actively try to hide them. Home test, screening for dementia. If you're not sure whether your loved one is having cognitive problems, try one or two of these simple tests. Ask the person to draw a clock showing the time as 10 minutes after 11 o'clock. The trick is to put the long hand and the short hand in the right places. Ask them to name as many animals as they can in a minute. If they can list more than 20 animals, that's about normal. Can your loved one determine 25% of $22.50? If not, and that person does finances, he or she needs evaluation. This is a simple calculation. If this is challenging, this person isn't able to address more complex financial decisions. If your loved one is having trouble with these or other areas of daily living, then it's time to go to a doctor, but not just any doctor. Make an appointment with a geriatrician, a neurologist, or a physician recommended by the Alzheimer's Association. General practitioners are fine for many medical issues, but they typically aren't accustomed to the subtle signs of early dementia. So what is dementia? Although dementia research has increased exponentially since the 1980s, there is still much about it that isn't yet understood. Here, briefly, is an overview of what we know. First, let's be clear what dementia isn't. It isn't forgetting where your glasses are. It's not forgetting someone's name when you run into them at a party. It's not losing your train of thought when you're cooking dinner and trying to herd your children through their homework. These are normal lapses that affect all adults from time to time. In casual conversation, the words dementia and demented may take on a variety of meanings, everything from silly and goofy to hopelessly inept and crazy. In medicine, dementia has an exact definition with three key aspects. 1. The loss of short-term memory. It's not just forgetting names or not remembering what you were doing. The problems start when the patient forgets that he's forgotten, when his understanding of the past or of the future gets fuzzy. He doesn't just forget an appointment with the doctor. He forgets that he has been to the doctor and that the doctor has prescribed a change of directions for taking his blood thinners. He eats lunch and then can't remember doing so. When he asks for lunch, he's irritated to be told that he just ate. This type of memory loss makes it difficult for an elder to properly evaluate situations. 2. Memory problems that interfere with the tasks of daily life. An assessment system used by medical professionals calls such tasks instrumental activities of daily living. They are simply what you need to be able to do to live independently as an adult. Manage money, pay bills, shop for groceries, cook, and do the laundry, among other things. These are measures of so-called executive function and can be the first signs that something is wrong. Someone who has reached this point will probably sound okay socially, but not be able to function independently. That person has lost the ability to determine risk and to reason through abstract choices. He or she can be at risk from unscrupulous people who offer to take care of everything. With lower risk assessment skills, the elder is more likely to go along with plans that put personal finances at risk. People with dementia lose control of their daily routines or the instrumental activities of daily living. Missing appointments, leaving bills unpaid, not taking medications, not going out to get groceries, or not washing clothes. They become unable to manage routine tasks, balancing a checkbook, cleaning house, preparing a meal, or driving along familiar routes. The ability to perform the activities of daily living, such as dressing, bathing, grooming, toileting, and finally even feeding oneself, declines as the disease progresses. The person often doesn't recognize the need for help. 3. Altered social behavior or personality. A shy person may become promiscuous. An affectionate spouse becomes hostile. A trusting parent turns paranoid. Dementia makes it difficult to pick up on the social cues that we all rely on to interact with others. Most people don't understand that dementia is extremely variable. It's not just forgetting. It takes many forms. That's because damage to different parts of the brain causes different sorts of behavioral problems. Addressing behavioral problems is one of the central challenges of successfully managing dementia. To understand how best to treat dementia, we need to understand how the brain works. What causes dementia? In the simplest terms, dementia occurs when the brain is damaged. The damage may stem from any number of causes: traumatic injury, small strokes, alcohol or drug abuse, or plaques, those gummy lesions of protein that build up in the brain and block nerve cell communications. Whatever the cause, how the problem affects behavior depends on how extensive the damage is. It also depends on where the damage has occurred. A quick map of the brain. To understand your loved one's particular dementia, here's a basic outline of which brain structures do what. The hippocampus, with one lobe on each side of the brain, controls short-term memory. People with damage to this part of the brain may have a detailed memory of a football game 30 years ago, but not something you told them in the last 5 minutes. They may ask the same questions over and over. The frontal temporal lobes, in the front of the brain. They govern emotion, reasoning, and social inhibition. People with damage in these areas may start acting inappropriately. They can be quick to anger over a little thing. They may burst into tears at the drop of a hat. They may have lost control of their impulses. They may eat to excess. They may grab someone they find attractive, or misinterpret the actions of the young caregiver assisting with bathing as something they remember that had to do with their spouse and romance. They may decide on a whim to sell all their possessions. This is where risk assessment and judgment reside, and they are often the first functions to go when dementia develops. The parietal lobe, at the upper back of the brain, helps with sequencing, that is, which things go first, second, and so on. People with damage in this area have trouble remembering how to put things in order. They struggle to work their way through the multi-step process. They may put their underwear on after their pants, or they may sit down to dinner but then not know what to do at the table. The occipital lobe, at the lower back of the brain, controls vision and balance. People with damage here have difficulty balancing, seeing, and reading. They may have trouble seeing in three dimensions. They may have a hard time sensing how far away something is or how deep a body of water is. They may perceive a black mat on the floor as a giant chasm. They may not eat because they can't determine where their food is, or they may not drink because they can't tell the color of the cup from the surrounding table. Oddly, their vision may test normal. They may see objects clearly, but their brains aren't processing the information correctly. Glasses can't correct the vision problems because the trouble lies in the brain, not the eyes. Dementia comes in many forms. Dementia isn't just caused by Alzheimer's disease, though Alzheimer's is the most common and best known cause. There are many types of dementia, each with a different cause and subtle variations in symptoms. They each progress in very different ways. Alzheimer's disease. About 70% of those diagnosed with dementia suffer from Alzheimer's. The disease begins when amyloid proteins start to stick together, forming plaques between brain cells. These plaques appear to prevent the cells from signaling each other. Other proteins form tangles, or fibrils, within brain cells. These tangles destroy the structure of nerve cells in the brain and eventually lead to their demise. As the patient loses more and more brain cells, his or her mental abilities start to falter. People with Alzheimer's usually start to show symptoms and then begin a smooth, gradual decline until death. Once diagnosed, survival is typically 4 years for men and 7 years for women, though there have been cases as short as 2 years and as long as 15 years. In the beginning, the person becomes forgetful. He'll show personality changes, becoming more irritable, less empathetic, apathetic, or more anxious. Often, the loss of memory prompts those with Alzheimer's to become suspicious and paranoid. They lose the ability to perform routine tasks like driving safely, cooking, using the telephone, or managing finances. Later in the course of the disease, they lose the ability to dress and to use the bathroom. In the terminal stage, they lose the capacity to eat and swallow. Vascular dementia. We've all learned to watch out for the catastrophic strokes, blockages or bleeding in a significant blood vessel in the brain that can kill or severely damage a person's motor skills or mental abilities. But it's also very common for elders to have tiny microstrokes involving the blockage of smaller blood vessels, known as white matter ischemia. The brain is made of gray matter, which are the nerve cells on the surface, and white matter, which are the nerve fibers found deeper in the brain that connect the nerve cells. White matter ischemia leads to little scars that damage the ability of the brain to work in various areas. These white matter ischemic changes are so common that doctors often consider them just part of normal aging. Yet these strokes can cause very real changes in personality and mental function. Gradually, as more and more of these little strokes occur, parts of the brain begin to falter. This sort of dementia occurs in about 30% of people with dementia and may combine with Alzheimer's. Vascular dementia randomly takes out bits and pieces of a person's ability to function, making it tricky to diagnose and to treat. An elder may still operate at a very high level in some areas, but have debilitating blind spots in others. For instance, an elder may be able to play a complex card game like bridge, yet be unable to remember to pay bills regularly. A stepwise decline is the hallmark of this form of dementia. Vascular dementia progresses as a series of sudden decreases in function, such as abruptly losing the ability to sign one's name on a check or forgetting the name of the caregiver as the only sign of the stroke event. Some elders may be stable for months and decline in a stepwise fashion, slowly or quickly. Alcoholic dementia. Alcohol abuse causes brain deterioration that may eventually become dementia. Elders are much more sensitive to the effects of drinking, in part because they metabolize alcohol more slowly than younger people. Even one cocktail a day may render an older person at higher risk for dementia and decline. More than two drinks a day can result in chaos. This sort of dementia can cause dense amnesia, or complete or near-complete loss of memory. In an alcoholic, other kinds of dementia or any kind of mental illness can't be diagnosed until the elder has been dry for 6 months. If the elder stops drinking, he or she can often regain some, but not all, lost mental function. Wernicke-Korsakoff syndrome is more common in alcoholic dementia and leads to confabulation, or making stuff up, which might sound reasonable until you find out the real story. The biggest challenge is that once the brain damage leads to loss of judgment and disinhibition, there is no regulator on how much alcohol or any other drug is ingested until the person is managed in a controlled setting. Lewy body dementia. Abnormal protein deposits inside the nerve cells, called Lewy bodies, are a common type of progressive dementia. These tau proteins scar brain function. The condition is also seen in Parkinson's disease, which is often marked by tremors, rigid muscles, and slowed movement. One hallmark of this form of dementia is early onset visual hallucinations, seeing everything from abstract shapes to departed loved ones. Disorders of REM sleep are also a hallmark. Most people are immobile when they're having dreams, but those with Lewy body dementia often act out their dreams, kicking and hitting a bed partner. In addition to early onset visual hallucinations, Lewy body can also cause dramatic mood swings, from clear and sunny one day to delusional the next. Unfortunately, medications used to treat Parkinson's disease, drugs such as Sinemet, carbidopa, levodopa, that prompt the brain to produce dopamine, which regulates movement and mood, often worsen the paranoia, delusions, and hallucinations. As the disease progresses, the use of Sinemet may lead to more paranoia and delusions and a shorter period of improved movement. The doctor must attempt the delicate balance of enough Parkinson's disease medications to allow movement, but not so much that the person becomes paranoid, delusional, and angry. Progression of Parkinson's disease leads to stiffness, immobility, and finally loss of the ability to swallow. Frontal dementia. This dementia attacks the frontal lobes of the brain, the parts immediately behind the forehead that govern the emotion, reasoning, social behavior, and impulse control. Elders with frontal dementia may seem functionally normal. If asked by a doctor assessing their orientation, they can usually tell the date, time, and place. But they also may show incredibly inappropriate or unwise judgment. They may grope a caregiver who is trying to bathe them. They may give away tens of thousands of dollars they can't afford to lose to charities or swindlers. They may lose their speech or become obsessed with small details to the exclusion of allowing daily care. These elders run a high risk of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.